Hello and welcome for presentations about solitary pulmonary nodule. Actually, I want to talk about the role of the Fleischner's 2017 guidelines in the follow-up of the solitary pulmonary nodule. The scope of that presentation, starting by introductions, then malignant CT features of solitary pulmonary nodules, Fleischner's 2017 guideline, scenarios, conclusions and references. Introduction. As we know, the pulmonary nodules can be divided into solitary or multiple. Solitary pulmonary nodules should discriminate benign from malignant, as we will talk through that presentations today. And multiple pulmonary nodules can be cavitating or multiple more than 2 millimeter and multiple less than 2 millimeter. Multiple less than 2 millimeters should be subdivided into calcified or non-calcified, because calcified causes of the multiple pulmonary nodules less than 2 millimeters can be remembered by the mnemonic word shambo, from silicosis, hyperpara, histoplasmosis, alveolar microlithiasis, metastasis or mitral stenosis, or previous chickenpox exposures. And remember of the causes of non-calcified multiple pulmonary nodules less than 2 millimeters by the test match specials from TB, metastasis, silicosis, or sarcoidosis. I have one presentation talking on details about the multiple pulmonary nodules with calcification, and I will leave the description as a link in the description if anyone interested to read about it. And also, the mnemonic word cavities can remember the causes of the solitary cavitating or multiple pulmonary nodules more than 2 millimeters, as we discussed before also in previous presentation. Our presentation today about these lesions. If we presented by the solitary pulmonary nodules as we note in these different patients, as that solitary pulmonary nodules in the mid zone of the left lung, or that solitary pulmonary nodules which also thrombose the left hilum, and here at the upper paramediastinal regions, and left upper loop solitary pulmonary nodule, as we see here. This is our talk today, solitary pulmonary nodule. What is the causes for this, and how can discriminate malignant from benigns, and what is the next step follow-up? That is which I will talk today in that presentation. So, the differential diagnosis of solitary pulmonary nodules can be remembered by the word cavities from cancer, primary or secondary, autoimmunes, Wegener's or rheumatoids, vascular, septic emboli, AVM or infections, infection inflammations like hamartoma or granuloma, fungal infections, viral or abscess, TB, sarcoidosis, silicosis, sequestrations, or Langerhans cholestasis. This is the cause of solitary pulmonary nodules. Actually, when I presented in my study by solitary pulmonary nodules, the main issue and the main rule of radiologist is to discriminate benign from malignant. And this is another word of cavities. This is mnemonic words to remember the causes of solitary pulmonary nodules. And as we described before, this can be used in the differential diagnosis of multiple pulmonary nodules starting from 2 millimeters until 30 millimeter, and multiple cavitating lung lesions. I have also one presentation talking in details about these cavities. I will leave the link in descriptions for any interesting one to read it. So, what is the definitions of the solitary pulmonary nodules? As we mentioned before, solitary pulmonary nodules should be less than 3 centimeters and not associated with atelectasis or lymphadenopathy. These solitary pulmonary nodules, by these definitions, can be either benign or malignant. However, of the size, if the size of the nodules is become more than 3 centimeters, it's called pulmonary mass, and this is usually malignant. So solitary pulmonary nodules can be malignant and or benign, and this is our rule as a radiologist to discriminate benign from malignant solitary pulmonary nodule. So let's start our presentation. CT features of malignancy to discriminate benign from malignant of the solitary pulmonary nodule. The first and the most important one is the margin. As the solitary pulmonary nodules, if there are corona radiata or speculated margins like these solid solitary pulmonary nodules, this raises the possibility of malignancy. Even if these ground glass solitary pulmonary nodules have the corona radiata or radiating margin, this meaning is a highly suspicious for malignancy. The second item is the air bronchogram. As the presence of these lucences, linear and dots of lucences within the solid nodules raise the possibility of malignancy comparing with these solid nodules which having no air bronchogram, and this was fungal infections, however this one is adenocarcinoma. Also, presence of solid and the ground glass component within the nodules raise the possibility of malignancy. As comparing with this nodule and that nodule, we see here ground glass opacity only. However, in that nodules, in subpleural locations and irregular outlines, there are solid component and there are cystic and ground glass component, and this raises the possibility of malignancy, as we see here 2 to 3 comparing with this one 1 to 5 comparing with benign and malignant. As we see here, there are 4 different patients with solitary ground glass pulmonary nodule. These nodules in the biopsy confirm the invasive adenocarcinoma, mixed type adenocarcinoma, and that nodule also was a bronchoalveolar cell carcinoma. However, this subpleural nodules with irregular margins is confirmed by biopsy as inflammatory tissue and fibrosis. Also, this one are benign. So, if we present it by ground glass pulmonary nodules, the risk is high to be malignant. As we see here, we cannot discriminate from the imaging alone, is it malignant or benign. So, we should take care with the ground glass pulmonary nodule. CT halocyan. If we present it by nodule like this, pulmonary nodule solids and surrounding by ground glass opacity, this is also features of highly suspicious. And the halo signs representing for these pictures of the sunshine with halo surrounding it. So if presented with nodules like these halo signs, this raises the possibility of malignancy also. And there are differential diagnoses for CT halo sign as invasive aspergillosis in the patient with immune compromised, as hypervascular or hemorrhagic metastasis, granulomatosis with polyangiitis, which is have previous name is Wigner's granulomatosis, Kabushi sarcoma, invasive mucinous adenocarcinoma, also which have a previous name of the bronchoalveolar cell carcinoma. So from the 5, there are 3 malignant: hypervascular metastasis, Kabushi sarcoma, invasive mucinous adenocarcinoma. So there is a possibility of malignancy with the CT halocyan also due to this ground glass opacity is should be take care from the CT halocyan. And is it females 60 years old with history of acute myeloid leukemia, presented with these nodules in the left upper loop of the lung and superior segment of the right lower loop with ground glass halo, as we see here. In this immune compromised patient, it was diagnosed as invasive aspergillosis. So here we are. Yes, we are talking about the CT features of malignancy, and we finished 3 already. The margins, when be speculated or corona radiata, raise the possibility of malignancy. Presence of ground glass within the nodule or air bronchogram raise the possibility also of malignancy. The fourth item is the calcifications. As we see in that diagram, diffuse calcifications like this. Calcification can be presented central like this, or popcorn like this in the cases of hamartoma, for example, or concentric like this. Alternative layers of calcification. These 4 types of calcifications are benign CT features for the calcified pulmonary nodules and representing granuloma or ordered granuloma or like this. However, if the calcifications is presented with this pattern of ground glass opacity or eccentric pattern like this, this raises a possibility of malignancy. And that patient is presented was solitary pulmonary nodule with central calcifications like this pattern of diagram, and this patient from Ohio River Valley, so this raises the possibility of histoplasma capsulatum infections, and it was a histoplasmoma. The fifth item is the gross. And the gross can be measured, calculated by the volume doubling time. The volume doubling time is because the most of the Balmoral nodules are usually spherical in shape. So the volume of a sphere by this equation, the 4 by r cube divided by 3, we can measure the volume of the solitary Balmoral nodules. And when these volumes be doubling, what is the time to be doubling? This is meaning by the volume doubling time. If the doubling time occurring less than 20 days, this representing infection or inflammation. Or if this doubling time is more than 400 days, it's usually benign. However, the malignant solid solitary pulmonary nodule usually have a volume doubling time less than 100 days with range between 20 to 400 days. So the volume doubling time is another character which can discriminate malignant from benign. The sixth is the shape. As the polygonal shape pulmonary nodules is usually benign, as that polygonal shape pulmonary nodules which have multiple faces and multiple sides like this, by equations we can divide the transverse diameters on the vertical diameters if the ratio is more than 1.78 was a sign of benignity also. The seven is the fat. Presence of fat in the pulmonary nodules like this raises the possibility of benignity, as that patient with a known primary and have malignancy and metastasized to the liver, and the chest CT presented with these pulmonary nodules. However, presence of this fat, which measuring by minus 46 Hounsfield units, raises the possibility of the benignity of that lesions, even the patient have a metastasis to the liver from the primary and known primary. So, presence of fats raises the possibility of benignity, and should be noted also liposarcoma metastasis and lipoid pneumonia can be present by fat in the solitary pulmonary nodule. The eighth item for the CT features of malignancy is the contrast enhancement. If the contrast enhancement less than 15 Hounsfield unit, raises the possibility of benignity by that ratio. And PET-CT also is a very good tool and useful tool for diagnosis of the malignancy. PET has a very high sensitivity, reaching to 95%, but specificity is only 81%. PET has PET fields that false positives with granuloma and the false negative with the small size pulmonary nodule less than 1 cm. Should be take care from these issues with using the PET only. And now we will talk about the Fleischner's 2017 guidelines, which is representing follow-up of the solitary pulmonary nodules and timing of follow-up. This Fleischner's guidelines only applied in the subject 35 years or older. And as we know, the first published of the Fleischner's is at 2005, then first update in the 2013, and last update at 2017, which perhaps most important one for the follow-up of the solitary pulmonary nodules as a Fleischner guideline. So let's start. As we mentioned, the Fleischner guideline only applies for subject 35 years or older, and the risk factors for the Fleischner guidelines is the history of heavy smoker, exposure to asbestos, radium or radium, family history of lung cancer, old age, six male, female more than male, and race black more than whites. As we know before, the Fleischner's have a high risk for the patient. Today, nowadays, the new updating is also including the risk about the nodule. Margin speculations, upper lobe locations, multiplicity, and the presence of emphysema or pulmonary fibrosis as a background. All these factors are risk factors and consider risk factors in the Fleischner 2017 guideline. Pulmonary nodules can be completely solid or subsolid. Subsolid meaning partly solids like this and a complete or pure ground glass. What about the solid pulmonary nodules? This is the Fleischner guidelines. You can remember it. You can save it in your mobiles or you can remember in your minds as you like. If the nodules less than 6 mm and single with low risk, no routine follow-up. However, if high risk, optional CT 12 months. Multiple nodules with low risk no routine, multiple nodules less than 6 millimeters with high risk, optional CT at 12 months. 6 to 8 millimeter, if single, low risk CT at 6 to 12 months, then consider CT at 18 and 24. High risk CT with 6 to 12 months, then CT at 18 and 24. If multiple, low risk CT at 3 to 6 months, then consider CT at 18 to 24. If high risk CT with 3-6 months, then CT 18 to 24. If the nodule is more than 8 millimeters in diameters, single nodules all, consider high risk or low risk, consider CT at 3 months, then PET CT or biopsy if still persist or increasing in size. If multiple nodules with low risk CT 3 to 6 months, then consider CT at 18 to 24. High risk CT with 3 to 6 months, then CT at 18 to 24. As we mentioned before, you can remember it, you can save it in your mobile, you can copy it, hard copy in your office. Anywhere, but you should know how to follow up the solitary pulmonary nodules according to the size as the Fleischner 2017 guideline. If the subsolid nodules with ground glass less than 6, no need for follow-up. If more than 6, CT 6 to 12 months to confirm persistence, then CT at 3 and 5 years. If partly solids like this, partly solids and other ground glass less than 6 millimeters, no need for follow-up. More than 6 millimeters, CT 3 to 6 months to confirm persistence, then annual CT for 5 years. If multiple ground glass nodules less than 6, CT with 3 to 6 months, if stable CT at 2 and 4 years, if more than 6 millimeter CT to 3 to 6 months, subsequent management based on the most suspicious nodules. So how to measure the nodule? This is the way which you measure the nodules. You take the dimensions of the average long and short axis and then round it to the nearest millimeters. For example, for this solid nodule, we dimension 7 as the longest diameters and 3 as the shortest diameters. 7 summations by 3 is 10, divided by 2 to take the mean, it equals 5. So the size of these nodules is 5 millimeters. And also the ground glass with partly solids and the ground glass. This is a way to measure the solitary pulmonary nodules and to detect the size of the solitary pulmonary nodule. So now let's talk about some scenarios. Scenario one, I presented with 5 millimeter solid nodules in high risk subject. So this 5 millimeters in high risk subject in the left upper loop, with lobulated outlines as we see here. In the follow-up study, after 12 months, we found that nodules become 13 millimeter. And so this is suspicious for malignancy. And in histopathology, analysis reveals the invasive adenocarcinoma, and all the name is the bronchoalveolar cell carcinoma as we mentioned before. So the malignancy detected through the follow-up according to this scenario. Second scenario presented with 6 millimeter partly solid pulmonary nodules. As we see, there are solid component and the ground glass component here in that nodules in the right middle loop. In the follow-up study, we noticed that after 1 year, we noticed that the whole size of the nodules is slightly decreased. However, the solid component become more prominent. And in the follow-up after 2 years, the solid component is increasing in size. Whatever the whole size of the nodules is decreased, and this is highly suspicious for malignancy and invasive type. Scenario 3, presented with multiple pulmonary nodules of partly ground glass opacity and solid in the middle loop, right middle loop and right lower loop. And these multiple nodules 6 millimeters in diameters. In follow-up study, 6 months later, disappears and representing inflammations or infections. Another scenario for solid pulmonary nodules, which shown here in the left lung, with ground glass opacity, and this is solid nodules with central areas of cystis and the linear area of cystis, and the presence of the air bronchogram within the nodules, as we mentioned before, raise the possibility of malignancy. In follow-up study after 6 months, we noticed that the solid component is increased with irregular outlines and slightly radiculars and irregular margins, and this was an small invasive adenocarcinoma in the biopsy. So this is the importance of the guidelines which follow up the suspected nodules and raise the possibility of malignancy and save the patient from metastasis or increase in size or spread or like this. The fifth scenario is the cystic lung lesions with intramural cystic solid component within the cyst. In the sagittal view, in the same patient, we see the size of the solid component within the cyst, which raises the suspicion of malignancy in that nodule located at the right lower lobe. And the highly suspicious of malignancy from the intramural solid component is very high also and should be taken care. Scenario 6, we're talking about the perifacial nodule. If the nodule is based on the fissures, and it should be discriminating if that typical perifacial nodule like this, which is based on the fissures and triangular in shape, or a typical perifacial nodules like this, which have a convex border in one side and the other side is rounded and also related to the fissure. If we're talking about typical perifacial nodules, the CT not recommend any follow-up for the typical perifacial nodules, even it larger than 6 millimeter. And these perifacial nodules consider the intrapulmonary lymph node. However, the typical perifacial nodule should be suspected until proven otherwise. And this diagram representing the perifacial nodules for the suspected perifacial nodules which have suspected features for malignancy, if it have speculated contour like this, or if it has transmigrations through the fissure like this, or it causing fissural distortion like this, or if it juxta fissural nodules like this, which just touching the fissure, all these are the nodules which have suspicious of malignancy, and these nodules should be take care from it. Scenario 7, this is 5 millimeter the perifacial nodules which have a ground glass opacity and irregular outlines. In the follow-up study after 2 years, we notice the increased density of the nodules and also the soft tissue component which is at the fissural side, as well as distortions of the fissure which is more than the previous study in the 2 years before. So this is highly suspicious of malignancy. If we find the distortion of the fissures and increased density with soft tissue component like this, this is highly suspicious for malignancy. And now the scenario 8 is the perifacial nodule, which appearing here in the right middle loop. And this juxtafissural nodules about 5 millimeters. In follow-up study 12 months later, it increasing in size and also increasing density with irregular and lobulation outlines. In the histopathology, it was proven that a small invasive adenocarcinoma at resection. So to conclude, the role of radiologist with solitary pulmonary nodules, he have two rules. The first one is how to discriminate the probably malignant from benign nodules. And the second rule is what is the recommendation, the follow-up periods or invasive technique according an official guideline like Fleischner's 2017 guidelines, which is a most recent one. And I hope clarify a lot of confusions about the solitary pulmonary nodule discriminations of malignancy and how to follow up. And this is my reference. Thank you very much for your listening and have a nice time.